that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're a living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. My heart becomes free. And my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You are living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. Where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your
everybody.
Good morning.
Isn't that awesome? They did a good job. Good morning. All right. right. Well, welcome to Family in Faith. It's an amazing day to be alive. We're very grateful. We have some excitement going on today. Lots of it, actually. Baby Anaya will be getting dedicated, so we're pretty excited about that. Before we jump into that, also want to welcome everybody here, those of you online, welcome. Thank you for choosing to come and worship with us. And I want to say, tomorrow is Veterans Day. So at this time, I want to recognize, and if you are able to please stand, anyone who is a veteran. We want to recognize you. Don't want to stand? Yeah, he's going to do it. I know we have one for sure. For those of you online, his shirt says every day is Veterans Day, and I couldn't agree more. And we want to just thank those that are serving our country as well. That is huge. And we're very grateful for all that our servicemen and women do for our country and for us. I think often we take it for granted. So thank you again, Paul, and everybody else that has served our country. Also want to say we do have our offering box in the back. We thank you in advance for supporting the ministry of Family and Faith Church. It is a call to our hearts to support the church and do what we can do, not the church saying, hey, we need your money, because we don't. God wants your hearts. It's not about the money. Also, you can give online via PayPal, and you could also do Venmo. We kicked in with Venmo, and they said that's very beneficial, so we have Venmo as well. And good old mail. You know, it's always fun to receive that little check that is with a card that says, hey, thanks for doing everything you're doing. So we're very thankful for that as well. Also, we do have our announcement sheets are in back. Please be sure to grab one of those, and that gives you an update of what's going on in the church. And we have a change, so if you have one at home, try to make a note of our little change. Renee messed up, but then I fixed it. So here we go. This coming Wednesday, we are doing organization for the Operation Christmas Child. So the adults will be organizing that up in the other building. And then the youth are still meeting, okay? So be sure, youth group, you share that with your youth. You are still going to be meeting. Then on the 20th, I have that small group is meeting. And last week, I'm like, no, we're not. Yes, we are. But we're not going to do small group. We're going to do a Friendsgiving and just have fellowship. So everybody bring a potluck. That isn't just for youth groups or small groups. Anybody is invited to come to Friendsgiving on the 20th. So be sure to just come, have food, have fellowship, and just have time together. So we invite you to come and do that on the 20th, 5:45. It says 6 o'clock on here, but we usually start. It says eat 5:45. So I'm very good. All right. So that is what we have for that. We also have Live a Loving Life cards back there. That is welcome. Please take those as well. Operation Christmas Child Pack is next Sunday at 10:30, so right after church, and we will go pack boxes up there. If you're going, what's OCC? Operation Christmas Child. It's where we have been collecting items to go in 100 shoe boxes. That is what we're shipping out. And then we pay, and we have them shipped off. Bethany Alliance Church actually is our drop place, and then they ship them to the next location, and then they go to a third world country, area that is needed. And often this is the only Christmas gifts that these children receive. So we take our toothbrushes for granted. They look at it as a gift. So we will be packing those next Sunday at 10:30. Please bring your gifts for collection in the big box back there for Grant County Christmas for Kids. It is through Family Life Radio. Many of us listen to that on 88.1. They are hosting this for our Grant County Christmas for Kids. So there's a little note on the side of it. And often that's the only gift that some children get right here in Grant County. And we have cupcakes and a lot of food in the kitchen. So please help yourself to that. If you want to get up and go eat now, kids do, of course. If you want to go get something, feel free to do that. But there's a lot of goodies back there, and the cupcakes are in honor of Anaya's dedication. Do we have any other announcements that I have missed? No? All right. Tennessee usually does this, so. Okay. Our prayer list. Celebration, we want to celebrate any birthdays and anniversaries. Do we have any of those? No? Nobody's being shy? Okay. We do want to celebrate, again, Anaya's dedication. Folks we want to pray for. Folks with heart issues. There seems to be a lot of stuff going on with people's hearts in the medical field, so we want to lift up those people that are dealing with that. Also want to continue to pray for Andrea Landon, back and health issues. She's doing better, but please keep praying for her. Relationships overall. So that means not just our relationships here on earth, but our relationships with Jesus Christ. Anybody dealing with depression, anxiety, addiction, suicide, tough conversations, hard stuff to cope with, but very real, so we keep praying for those. We want to lift up Alex in Uganda, continuing to pray for him and his group. Mark Drew, brain surgery, and still continuing to fight. New beginnings, whether that's new jobs, new offices, new relationships, new whatever it may be, new beginnings, new relationship with Jesus. May Adney, continuing to pray for her. Adding Jerry Mercer, he is not feeling well, so we want to lift up Jerry. Matt Johnson, David in Kenya and his family, Karen's friends and family, Larry Brandemule, continuing to lift him up in prayer, and then our blanket prayer for many that don't want their names listed, but we want to pray for friends and family with health issues and struggles, hospitalization, whatever it may be. Our cancer list, unfortunately, has grown, but on the flip side, we also have a celebration. So, Christina Blake is cancer-free. So that is our celebration from that cancer list. Others that we have on our cancer list are Richard Leeser, Misty Kohler, Luke, our fourth grader, Kathy Smith, Allison Meyer, Sandy Rich, Travis Washburn, Quinton Ambort, Kitty Hartley, Oakland Peterson, Daryl Allen, and also another add-on is Shannon Millen. Many of you know Shannon, so we lift up Shannon and dealing with cancer. Deaths that we want to lift up as well, John Mitchell's family, that would be Jolly, so we want to pray for their family, and his visitation is this afternoon. Family and friends of loved ones, Heather Kramer and her two sons, we continue to pray for that family. And then Patty Wells and her family and friends, we continue to pray for as well. Our general, we want to pray for the harvest season and everybody to be aware of the tractors and all that's out there. That's still going on, starting to wind down a little bit. Natural disaster, seems like there's all sorts of any kind. Yes?
Wayne Tillotson family,
thank you, Jeff. Wayne Tillotson family, Wayne passed yesterday, and we want to lift him up in prayers as well. Young guy. Thank you, Jeff. Natural disasters being wildfires, snowstorms. Colorado has a whole lot of snow. Tornadoes and, of course, hurricanes. Just continuing to pray for all of them. And then our government, the election outcome, and what that means for our country. Again, for our military and the wars that are going on in our entire world. So we want to lift all of that up in prayer because we know prayer works and it's very, very powerful. Also special prayers, I would also like to ask for Jake. Yes?
Update on Quinton Ambort.
Yes.
Tests have come back remarkably well. He gets to go back to school.
Awesome. Quinton's been on here a long time, too. Thank you. That's awesome. Awesome. Thank you. That's cool. God is good. All the time. Father God, you are so good. Even when things are not those good test results, Lord, you are still good. And Lord, as we come to you this morning with humble hearts, lifting you up, praising your name, however that looks like for each one of us. Lord, we are grateful to you for that. Father, continue to move within all of us. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. You are welcome here in every one of our hearts. We pray for healing of all kinds. Lord, we continue to pray for our nation. We pray for churches. We pray for those who do not know who you are. We also ask that you would forgive our sinfulness. You would make us new and whole. And sometimes we say, wow, why us, Lord? And that's not a question we should ask, but what we should do is just lean in on you. Help us to have our eyes, our ears, our hearts, and our minds open to the amazing things that you do every day in our lives. Thank you, Lord, for this church family, wherever we may be, online and physically here. Thank you also for Anaya's dedication and for her parents and family to lift her up and help her to grow in her faith journey. And Lord, as we go out into the world after church today, have our hearts remain solid with you. Help us to truly walk the talk and to love and be kind. Still having boundaries, but putting you first and foremost. Father, work in me to deliver your message that you've presented. Help us all to hear. And may this be the best hour of the new week. As we pause for time of silent prayer, God, we give it to you. Thank you, Father God, for little voices. Help mom and dad and everybody know that it's just fine because you said, your son Jesus said, let the little children come to me, and they're here. Father, thank you for that. May we join together with hearts like children for the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All right, worship team switched up a little bit more. Come on up, and we're going to do a song that's pretty traditional. And we ask you to stand if you are able and want to for this next song.
This is Trinity's new favorite.
Not my new favorite.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. Let's do His good will. He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil He doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, not a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But we never can prove the delight.
Somebody else. Yeah. That's always so fun. Hi, fast runner. How are you? Good morning, everybody. How are we? Oh, gracious, safe. Good deal. Here, I'll scoot over. There you go. How is everybody this morning? Tessie, how are you over there? Good. Hey, I have a question for you guys. Did any of you get scared of anything this week? Anything scare you this week? Anybody get scared this week? Nobody saw any big spiders, snakes, mice, rats, nothing that scares us. How about anybody come around the corner and scare you? Yeah, see, that happens, right? Darn them. It's always fun to scare people, but boy, when they scare you back, that happened, yeah? All right, so I have a question for you. Often we hear faith over fear, right? What does that mean? What does that mean?
Believe.
To believe. To believe what? You didn't know you were going to be part of this, did you?
God's got it.
God's got it. Yeah. So when we get scared of something, can I pick on you? No? You can tell me no. I'm not really picking on him, Oliver. It's okay. So maybe when you're running and you might get a little nervous or you might get in your head a little bit. I know this doesn't happen with you, but I'm saying might for a reason. Sometimes that happens to runners or ball players. You see it a lot in ball players where something gets in their head and they kind of mess up on what they're doing. And then what's a really good thing that we can do? What can we do if we ever get in a situation like that we kind of get in our head or in our heart and we get kind of messed up thinking? What can we do?
Pray.
We can pray and go, oh God, help me get this figured out. Help me to know what I should be doing. Here's another question. Has anybody this last week, did anybody get in an argument? Faith followers, get ready for this. Has anybody gotten in an argument with somebody this week?
I just had an argument
with my dad.
See?
Okay, so there's an argument. Your sister, you got an argument with your sister. So what do we do when we want to argue? What should we do if we want to argue? Or maybe after we argue, what should we do? What else? Yes, pray is good. Please forgive me, right? What do we do? No, don't do that. What do? Can we say, hey, can you please forgive me? I really shouldn't have. You know, if that is where you belong to do that, right? Say, hey, you know what? It probably wasn't good for me to argue with you, Dad.
Well, he said I
could have
after, but I wanted
now. Well, sometimes patience is the best virtue, right? How about you leave your brother alone? All right, so faith over fear, and when we argue, let's think what we're arguing about, okay? Can we do that? Be love, be kind, okay? Let's do that. All right. Because, you know why? That's what it says in the Bible. Right? All right, let's pray. Dear God, thank you for your word, the Bible. Help us when we get afraid that you are there. And when we want to argue, to think twice, to be loving and to be kind. Thank you for your son, Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. All right, and there's snacks if you are Abram. Otherwise, there's treats over there, some candy. And worship team has another song for us. Ireland, you didn't want one? You're okay, okay.
No, I need to like down. Everybody sing along.
In the hands beyond the sea, countless million children be, who have never heard the gospel story told. We the ones for whom Christ died and brought them with a price, waiting to be gathered in the Savior's fold. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Everywhere we hear them cry, come and save us as we die. Who will haste to seize the blessed news to tell? Hey, you're precious to the King, let us go these lambs to bring to the gracious arms of Him we love so well. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. The east and from the west, see them thronging to be blessed. Precious jewels to adorn His diadem. If we have so obeyed the Lord, we shall reap a sure reward when He comes again to gather us and them. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
That worked out perfect. As I said, we are blessed this morning to have the dedication of Anaya Lynn Collins, sleeping. She'll wake up in no time. I hope the water's still a little warm. And it is truly our privilege. And Anaya is the daughter of Anthony and Colin. Sorry, Amber Collins, otherwise known as Tennessee. That's who most of you know him as. As we are reminded today of the importance of our faith, and we need to show the love for God and others in all that we do. It's very important. In Matthew 19:14, Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." Jesus loves us all, especially the little children. And I think that's why many of us in life look at children and go, what do when we see little babies? It's in us because Jesus loves the little children too. And may we all become like children, fully trusting Jesus with our lives. The belief of Family in Faith Church is that dedication of infants is very important, and that the parents are pledging to raise their children in godly ways and leading by example the importance of faith in life's journey. The congregation, meaning all of you and those of you out there online, also have a role of being godly examples. As Anaya's journey continues, she will grow in her faith and decide at a more mature age what her faith journey will involve, at which time she can choose to be baptized in the faith. As a little side note, we just had one of our youth who is at college be baptized in her faith. So cool. Very cool. In Scripture, baptism was only done on adults because they personally chose to follow Jesus. There were households that were baptized, so there may have been children there, but that we don't know. More importantly, though, baptism does not guarantee a spot in heaven. However, by God's grace, accepting and believing Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and leading a godly life does. Infant dedication implies that the parents, Amber and Anthony, publicly profess their love of God and truly wish for their children to love and follow Jesus. In Psalm 127, it says that children are a blessing from the Lord, and as Christ followers, we are called to recognize that children belong to God first and foremost. They are a gift to us as parents. There's no greater moment, and I've witnessed this so many times, than when parents sense that their child is a gift from God. It's so wonderful. And dedicating a child acknowledges God's sovereignty, not only over the child, but also the parents. We have the godparents and parents up here now. For all of you, by coming forward, you are declaring your desire to dedicate yourselves to Jesus Christ. If this is true, please say, I do. Amber and Anthony, do you declare your desire to dedicate Anaya to Jesus Christ? If so, please answer, we do. Do you promise, so another promise, another vow, to love God with your God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength, so your children may walk in the abundant life that God offers? Do you vow by God's help and in the partnership with Tina and Stephen and this church or a church to provide a Christian home of love and peace to raise both of your children at this time in the truth of our Lord's instruction and discipline, to learn God's word so it will be on their hearts, on your hearts, and to encourage them to trust Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior? And if so, please answer, we do. Stephen and Christina, you're back there. Modeling this kind of love and support cannot be done alone. It requires help of others, like godparents, like yourselves, and support of family and friends. Stephen and Christina, do you declare your desire to help Amber and Anthony fulfill these vows? And if so, please answer, we do. Grandparents and great-grandparents, in Proverbs 17:6, it says, grandchildren are a crown for the aged. Life is truly a generational cycle. These children are blessed to have grandparents and great-grandparents. In your role, will you pledge to assist and encourage Anaya to be raised to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, raised in a church, and grow in her faith? If so, please answer, we do. Finally, I ask everybody known as the church to make a vow. By your presence here today, whether you're physically here or online, you declare yourselves to be children of God, and with God's help, you will proclaim God's word and live according to the example of Christ. Will you surround Anaya with a community of love and forgiveness that she may grow in her faith and walk in the way that leads to life everlasting? If you do agree to this vow, please say, we will. We will. Here's the part that's going to be cool. She heard the crazy lady's voice. Hi, baby girl. Hi. I hope it's warm. Isn't she just precious? Hi, everybody. Lord God, we dedicate this amazing miracle of a child to you so that her life will be full, rewarding, and that she follows your life, your plans, and your purpose for her. It's not warm. We dedicate you to a life full of faith. In the name of the Father. Ooh. In the name of the Son.
I get it. There we go. Oh, that's tough stuff being a baby. Here is our dedicated, beautiful Anaya Lynn Collins. Welcome her. She likes bright lights. I know those allergies, right? I'm going to come over by you guys and we're going to do a laying of the hands on her. For those of you that don't know, allergies are when we all cry. Do you want to get them there? They can come up. Sure, that's a good thing. Come on now. Up, yeah, up. Here we go. Ready? There we go. Put your hand on Sissy. Here, put your hand up on Sissy. There you go. Father God, we thank you for the life of Anaya Lynn Collins. Sometimes life has very unexpected things that go on, but Lord, miracles do happen. And this family, the Adney family, Collins family, they have truly witnessed some true miracles. Lord, bless Anaya's life. Be with her parents, her godparents, her family. Guide her, lead her. Show her your ways, your purpose, your will, your plan for her life. Be with the little ones, even the not so little ones, as they continue to venture in life. Guide them, Lord, protect them. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Baby girl. We have a gift for you guys over there. Her certificate is in there as well. Congratulations. It wasn't it awesome? Well, maybe. Who knows? Out of the mouths of babes, truly. I was talking to some youth kids on Wednesday night, and they said something about Wednesday, we're tired, and I said, it's one of the second best day of the whole week. And they looked at me really confused. Second best day? I said, yeah, Sunday's the best day. And they're like, oh yeah. I don't know about you, but I truly feel that way. It can be a pretty crappy week, but come Sunday, I'm like, yeah, let's go. Let's go worship. It is wonderful. We can worship in the car. We can worship wherever we may be. But there's just something about church and coming together in a community of faith. A few months ago, we talked for a couple weeks on generosity. And since it is grateful and thankful season of Thanksgiving, we're going to talk about some generosity. We're not talking just about money, although a big topic of this is money. Because I'm with you, I don't like talking about money, but we can be generous with our time, our talents, our knowledge, and there is a list of scripture that talks about, and I was kind of amazed with this, to be perfectly honest. I printed off scripture that talks about finances and money. Here you go, it's pretty thick. There's many, many pages of scripture that talks about this, so it was a big deal to God, and because of that, we're going to talk about it a little bit. A couple months ago, we talked about generosity. So let me refresh your memory. We talked about, I don't know if we have more than enough up there, the clip or anything. We talked about how we have more than enough. Does anybody feel like they have more than enough in life? I do. I don't know. I do. When we give, it reflects the heart of God. We also talked about what is God. God is love. What does God do? God gives. So if God is love and God gives, then it's natural that we can say that love gives. Now we just witnessed love, right? A new baby. A baby. We have an expectant mommy, a new baby, right? We all get a little excited about those sorts of things. So, if love gives, then I would suggest that you can't love without giving. I would invite all of you to think about something. What do you do on a daily basis that you've probably not considered is love? What do you do on a daily basis? Do you get up and make food for your family? Do you get up and go to a job to provide for your family? Do you give out hugs? Do you give out spankings? Because discipline is love, right? Maybe it's not spankings, timeouts, whatever it might be. We do so much out of love. We do so much out of love, and we don't even consider it. We are very generous, for the most part, with our love. And God is love. It comes to us naturally. There's also something that hit home to many of us with two different mindsets. And when after it was talked about, people were like, wow, that was really good. There's a bag mindset or a barn mindset. The bag mindset, we believe we don't have enough. You may say, I'd like to give more, but I don't have enough. In Haggai 1:6, it says, you eat, but you don't have enough. You drink, but you're not filled with drink. You clothe yourself, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages to put them into a bag with holes in it. Thank you, Paul. The bag mindset says no matter what comes in, it's not enough. And at the end of the month, there's nothing left in the bag. So we say things like, I want to give more. I want to be generous, but I don't have enough. And we think then I have more, then I'll give more. And that's the mind bag set. The barn mindset says we have more than enough. And in Deuteronomy 28:8, it promises that if you fully obey the Lord, this is what it says, the Lord will send a blessing on your barns and on everything you put your hand to. The Lord your God will bless you in the land he's given you. Does your bag have holes in it, or is your barn full? We also learn that giving is what we do, but generous is who we are. And the qualities of a generous giver are giving willingly, proportionately, and sacrificially. Anybody remember this stuff? Does it sound familiar? Perfect. Thank you. It's Thanksgiving time. We're thankful. We're grateful. Love the shirt. Give thanks to the Lord is what our shirt says. I need to dig mine out. Since it's the season, we're going to do two more weeks of More Than Enough, this week and next week, and pick up where we started our study in 2 Corinthians 8 and 9. 2 Corinthians 8 and 9, for those of you taking notes. This book is a letter that Paul wrote in correction. He was correcting the church in Corinth. They kind of were messing up, big time actually. They started wandering from what Paul had invested and taught them. Paul devoted two entire chapters talking about money, material things, and the transformating power of generosity because this group of Christians, they claimed they were going to help, and they did nothing. We are not like that. We don't want to be like that. Paul continues the idea of the bag and barn mindset in chapter 9. Before we go there, though, you guys get to do some thinking. Okay, so wake up. You're going to do some thinking. I want you to think about what you think about. Think about what your brain is consumed with, the thoughts your brain is consumed with. Think about those thoughts, okay? Make a mental note. Where are you at in life? Is your life between empty or abounding? Where are you at? And those things that you think mostly about is where your heart is. So the things we think about the most is where our heart is. The idea that is empty, I'm always fearful that I'm going to run out. Abounding, I have this deep sense of faith. God's got it. I'm good. I have enough. Paul begins with a universal truth in 2 Corinthians 9, and he says, remember this, and this is such a good verse, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Now this is interesting because Paul is beginning to make a case at this point in this chapter because it's 100% about money. But he makes this case about harvest, about seeds. Why? Because we understand that. In these times, almost everybody had to farm to make a living, to support just themselves. So he uses this so people can understand it. He's establishing the truth of the law of harvest. When we think about it, farmers don't look at seeds for what they are, do they? Farmers look at the seeds for what they will produce when they are planted. What will we produce when we invest and plant in others? That's what Paul's talking about here. This is a great analogy, perfect timing, because it's harvest season around here. Paul isn't talking about this because he wants to talk about money either. But he does talk about something that's important and that he knows people would relate to. Here's what I know, though. Whatever you choose to keep is all that you will ever have. But whatever you choose to sow or to give in faith is what God has the power to multiply. I know that for a fact. Seed turns to harvest. In the Bible, we see 3 money mindsets that shape how people choose to live. The first one, it's that everything that I have is mine, I've made it, and it's my choice to do with whatever I want. So Jesus says, he tells this parable because Jesus was such a good storyteller. He says this, watch out. He warns everybody, watch out. Be on your guard. It's almost as if he knew greed was going to take over, didn't he? Watch out, be on guard. He wants us to be careful that we don't get consumed and want abundance of possession. It's all for me. It's all for me. Mindset 1. Mindset 2. We clearly see in Scripture the first belongs to God. And look at what Solomon writes in Proverbs 3. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. And then your barns will be filled to overflowing and your vats with brim over with new wine. You're going to have abundant life. So that's mindset 2. And the last money mindset teaches, that Jesus teaches as we're calling, to live a sacrificial life. Shocker, it's not just the 10% of the tithe. Live sacrificially. Rely on the Lord. Everything I am, everything I have, belongs to God and is available to him. And in that same text in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus says to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple, so if you want to follow Jesus, you must deny yourself. Finish it out. What's it say? You must deny yourself, take up your cross, right? And follow me. Take up your cross daily and follow me. Whoever wants to save your life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me will save it. Give it all to him. That's mindset 3. Give it all to him. It's his. It belongs to him. He's just letting us borrow it. We got it on loan. Let's say that. Which one are you? Which mindset do you look at? And what if there is not, these are not money mindsets? What if these are a progressive journey? Like we start out with one, and then we go to 2, and then we end up in 3. And what I see is so cool, and it just happened. I'm going to share. Can I share permission? Okay. If I go over, I apologize.
This is what happens when we become generous and we allow the Holy Spirit to move within us. Last week, y'all remember it was Youth Sunday, right? The youth did awesome, didn't they? I was so proud of all of them. My prayer for many weeks prior is, Holy Spirit, move. Make a change. Make an impact. It's all up to you. It's up to you, Lord God. Out of last Sunday, before it even started, two young girls said, hey, we can do stuff whenever you want us to do it. Trinity and Caitlin had the Holy Spirit move. I've cried happy tears many times over this because it just doesn't happen. Now, if you remember, Kate also spoke. And you saw Kate has blossomed into this amazing faith-based young lady who isn't afraid to share her faith, who wants to go be a counselor at a Christian camp this summer. How cool is that, right? So we're mixed up in this world of negativity and ugly, but there is some really awesome stuff going on. We just have to be aware of it. We have to open our eyes and see. So the Holy Spirit still moves, and people are still being generous. These kids didn't have to be here at 7:45 this morning, but they want to be here at 7:45 this morning.
What do
they want? Oh, well,
she picked me up.
There you go. You are here. That's the whole thing. So let's take that a step further. What does a two-year-old or a young child often do when they have a toy? Well, except for Savvy and April. When they have a toy and another kid wants it, what do they do? What do they say? Oh, I think I just heard it. Ah, that was perfect, Savvy. Thanks for playing right into that. Mine! Mine! Isn't that how we are when it comes to our finances? Mine! 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 Can't have it. Mine! God doesn't want that. The church doesn't want that. Let me make it really clear. One of the biggest things that we said when Family and Faith was formed is we're not about money. God is going to take care of us, and we are not about money. We typically don't talk about it. There's a reason we don't pass a plate. However, God wants our hearts, and that is part of it. Your money isn't for my pocket. It's not for anything except for the support of ministry and for doing God's plan and will. Ministry at this church is huge. We do so much and try to do so much ministry because of God and for God. So when we think of a two-year-old, and the next time we're going through our checks and our money and our bills, which, by the way, I dislike that time of the month every time, twice a month, there's the stack of bills. Literally, we farm. There's the stack of bills. Okay, here we go. God makes it happen all the time. It works. It works. But we're not going to be that two-year-old who says, mine. We're going to say, God, this is yours. I'd like for you to think about this. We are called to be living sacrifices. So our destination is to give your whole life, right? What does that look like to you? And I want you just to think about that. It's our own journey. It's our personal journeys. What does that look like? That faith journey look like for you? Maybe it's going on a missionary trip. Maybe it's given more than 10%. Regardless of what you believe about the tithe, aren't you going to bypass giving 10% to God on your way to living a sacrificial life? Just think about that. I know I'm getting old. I know it because of the way I think. I really do. Jeff says to me, talk about humble. Let me just tell you this little story. Yesterday in the car, we're going to Platteville. And he says, do you almost feel like you're 60? Who says that? I said, well, actually, my body feels like I'm almost 60, but no, in my head, I don't feel like I'm almost 60. But I thought,
But he's right. He's before me, guys, just for the record. He's before me. But the thing about it is we start to think differently, we process differently, we love differently the older we get. And you know what's so cool? Is we get to share what we're living and learning with the younger generations. It is so awesome. We've all, on Wednesday nights, we've been doing this thing called discipleship and learning about that. And it's so cool. And that's what it's about. So we're learning this. I got this wisdom and knowledge, and I want to pass it on to this person, this generation. And I've seen, again, the Holy Spirit moving within our small group. It is so cool. Like, we can speak openly and share openly. But we are on our way to the sacrificial life. There's some things that go on that aren't necessarily monetary, but are very sacrificial. When a person goes through tragedy but does something to save so many other lives, sacrificial. When they go through a tragedy and they purchase Bibles for other people who are going to go through tragedies, that's sacrificial living. That's giving it all. There's stories on top of stories of that. We just need to open our eyes and see. Some of you are at God, the first is yours, and you recently gave your first tithe check. I want to encourage you to keep doing that. It's not the finish line of generosity, it's just the start. Then there's some of you that are like, I'm going to see how much I can really do. And you try to outgive God, which is so fun. You'll never do it. You can't do it. But it's fun to try. So keep trying. You know, if that's your mindset, keep trying, but you can never outgive God. And it's kind of fun when you're like, okay, here's this. Let's see what he does. Because he said, test me, didn't he? It's the only time in the Bible he says, test me. God says, test me about your finances. Let's do this. Right? And then some of you are saying, I don't want to give. Here's the good news for that. God can work with that. God can and he will work with that. No matter where you are today, every single one of us have one step, have another step to take, and we're all on the same journey. It's our destination of our end of life. It's our generosity journey. The journey of joyfully being generous starts with a decision. Look at what Paul writes in 2 Corinthians verse 7. Everyone must do what he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. So that is what Paul is instructing. We have a decision to make. And where is that decision coming from? Is it coming from our head? Where is it coming from? Our heart. It's coming from our heart. That is the word that made all the change for me. So, you know, back in the day of when I was not almost 60, and maybe none of you have done this, but you got your bills, you got your income, you go through your budget, and you're like, huh, this doesn't match up. And you get really freaked out. I still do that sometimes, but you get freaked out. And then it's like, all right, God, what do you want me to do with this? And he makes it clear. But the difference that it made to me, hearing that word heart, is you don't go through your budget. You don't go through your bills. You just go right off the top. God, the first is yours. The first fruits is where it's coming from. Because of all the things we do, why do we want to give God our leftovers? Here's something that used to really kind of, I used to go, what commercial was that? Things that make you go, what was that? Things that make you go, People used to, doesn't happen here, used to donate stuff they don't want anymore to the church. Here's my leftovers.
No, how about we give you, God, the first? I'll keep the leftovers. That's what it's supposed to be like. We give God the first fruits. We get what's left. And I'm here to tell you firsthand, He will multiply and fill your heart with generosity and love and protection. And He's got you. God's got you. I believe God is waiting for each and every one of us to make a decision. We're not just going to sit here and go, He wants us to make a decision. Generosity is not a business transaction. It's a spiritual transaction. Motive matters. He doesn't want your money. He wants your heart. We can be generous givers. Givers of our time, of our talents, of our prayers, of our love, of our words. Courtney has a support group that meets here once a month for parents that have lost children. That's being generous, being supportive. Each of you should decide from your hearts. We cannot use our brain, our budget, or anything else. What is God calling us to do? He's calling us to make a spirit-filled, loving, soul decision. Let's wrap it up with verse 10. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply the increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. That's so good. It's saying God's got it. He's going to increase. He's going to carry you through no matter what. Giving is a spiritual discipline. It's not a religious obligation. Now, if you're hearing this message, because I want you to hear this loud and clear. If you're hearing this message and thinking to yourself, oh, just one more thing God wants me to do or needs me to do, or the church needs my money, you've missed it completely. This is not an obligation. It's an invitation. It is an invitation to have your life transformed and have a great relationship with Jesus. We have more than enough, and we need to have confidence in knowing just that. Amen. All right, worship team, come on up. Whoever else, young folks, want to come up and sing. This is a really good song that wraps it up. And then Tennessee is going to close it up in prayer. You got enough there, love?
Yeah.
Okay.
Stand in worship, everybody.
Ireland, you coming up to sing?
I'm not a warrior. I'm too afraid to lose. I've been qualified with what calling me to do. The Lord with your strength, I've got no excuse. Cause the broken people are exactly what you use. Giving faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David. Lord, be my defense, so I can face my giants with confidence. You took a shepherd boy and made him a king. So I'm gonna trust you and give you everything. I'll be a conqueror, cause you fight for me. I'll be a champion, claiming your victory. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. Sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see him fall. Gonna stand out, step out when you call. Jesus, Jesus. I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. I won't stop until I see him fall. I'm gonna stand out, step out when you call. Jesus, you've been like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. I'll face my giants with confidence.
Let's join our hearts in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this morning. Lord, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for the sacrifice that your son made on our behalf. Lord, we thank you for new life. And Lord,